Yeah. What's interesting, I mean, in this region for the Filipinos is, unlike other areas where there's a threat of war, you have Filipinos wanting to come home. But so far in the last few months, have you actually repatriated Filipinos? I mean,
Yes,
you have, but those gone.
first of all, from Gaza, you know, we repatriated about 136. But then again, that is an incredibly untenable, that was an untenable situation. All right, so you have to leave that area. From Lebanon, because of the tensions in the area, there have been over 200 out of 17,000 who have gone home in the past several months. And Israel, around the same, a little more, because there have been 30,000, there are 30,000 Filipinos in general, in Israel. About 250 plus have gone home, including the latest batches a few weeks ago, 47. But in general, there are no indications of Filipinos telling the ambassadors in Beirut or in Tel Aviv that they are anxious to go home. If they want to go home, part of it is attention, but more of it is because they have no more jobs, or their visas have expired, or working visas, there's nothing anymore for them. And the early tension was right after the original attack on October 7th. Since then, the Filipinos in Israel have felt safe. So Ambassador Flores mentioned that. Lately, they haven't gone to the embassy, but we'll update you on that. We haven't raised the alert level. It's alert level 2 for Israel, meaning no new deployment of workers. Ambassador, Israeli ambassador is not very happy about that, I'm afraid.
So there are no new deployment of workers in Israel.
Since
And
last year,
I'm sure ang daming naghihintay.
pero yung mga nagtatrabaho na doon, pwede pumunta dito at makabalik. Pero
Okay. Oo.
ano naman, I mean, you can't fault the government naman because there is a difficult situation. I mean, the situation on the ground looks normal, but anything can happen at any time. So, and besides, the DMW and the Israeli government, they still have to finalize the agreement on the arrangements for the deployment of caregivers because there are rules that. Now, if I may go to Iran, there are 2,000 Filipinos there, but most of them are Iranian citizens because if you remember, without revealing her age, Ms. Davila, I've not blessed this with you. But in the 80s, ang daming Iranian students sa atin, di ba? Medicine. They came home not only with a diploma, but with a marriage
With their
certificate.
wives.
Right.
So,
And
pero ang
under
tanong po, wait, Undersecretary, are we deploying Filipinos to Iran? No.
Hardly. We're not deploying Filipinos to Iran because not because we're banning them from going to Iran, but because Iran is not needing Filipino workers. But you know, may mga Filipino doon who happen to be Iranian citizens because if you marry a foreign woman marries an Iranian male, automatically she becomes an Iranian citizen under Iranian law. So they are protected, and they are not asking to go home either. So I'm waiting for Ambassador Roberto Manalo, no relation to Foreign Secretary. He's our ambassador in Tehran, and he's going to call on the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, or he probably did yesterday. We're waiting for his support. It's still early morning there, so we'll see. But our chief concern now is, of course, the seafarers, and I think there will be positive news about that, that they'll be released pretty soon.
All right. Now, before we go, I want to take this opportunity anyway, since you are Undersecretary of the Department of Foreign Affairs, maybe not exactly in your purview, but just recently I was talking, I was speaking with political analyst Ronald Llamas, and you already have former President Duterte criticizing President Marcos Jr. for his foreign policy when it comes to the United States, clearly different from the foreign policy of former President Duterte. You were already in government during former President Duterte's time, so I'm sure internally you feel the shift of the foreign policy. What's your take on, I guess, the exchange of words at this point?
I heard the interview with Mr. Llamas, and he challenged the cabinet, even saying they should be defending the president. So I, an undersecretary is a sub-cabinet official. So let me defend the president. In fact, you defended the president already by saying we are who we are. And each president of the Philippines is effective in his or her own way, depending on how he or she runs things based on their personalities. You mentioned Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. Pinoy himself was regularly accused of being so laid back and not really being very on the go. And of course, we had a very strong style of President Duterte. And now we have the gentlemanly style of Bongbong Marcos. Is that a revelation? He was always a gentleman. And it is this gentlemanly-like style leadership which has led for most of his most vocal critics of the past, including, sad to say, I would have to say, ABS-CBN or the Yellows or before, Ms. Ressa perhaps, Laila de Lima, to be supportive of the president. So it comes with that. He is the commander-in-chief. He gives us quiet leadership and quiet instructions. And that is why we do all we can to protect our nationals. And I will also say something for the vice president. She is the elected vice president and a cabinet secretary. We are still working with her in the Department of Foreign Affairs. For example, in my unit in particular, we're in touch with her office because she is very passionate about the education of Filipino children in Sabah. And that's a particularly sensitive issue given. Yeah.
But what about the West Philippine Sea?
Well,
I mean, seriously.
I think her style is more respectful of the fact that the president is the chief architect of foreign policy. When it was under Duterte, he was not following a very pro-American path, needless to say. The president has returned us to the alliance of the United States. There is big prestige, great prestige in having a trilateral summit where the presidents of the U.S., the Philippines, and Japan are together. And that is it. And of course, her father thinks differently. But what is the president supposed to do? Is Mr. Llamas, and he's a good friend, Mr. Llamas, he's a great fellow.
But you have to remember, he's a political analyst. Huh?
Is he advocating?
Isn't personal at all.
Is he advocating that the president fight his own vice president? Then that would be chaotic. Weren't they concerned when President Duterte had this very, very strong, volatile leadership, which also effective in his own right? But now you have President Marcos, gentlemanly, quiet, measured in his words. We do think it's effective. I do think the people still support him, including on the West Philippine Sea. I must say also that among the critics, I would like to think they are not doing it because they are pro-China. Perhaps they are thinking that we should not be too allied with the U.S. and maybe have a more balanced approach. I would like to think everybody is pro-Philippines. And I think the president knows that. Of course, we have heard from the president himself. And he has his style, and I believe it's working. Certainly in the matter of migration issues, we have been successful. And that's in part due to the quiet leadership of the president.
On that note, I want to thank you for indulging me with that last question. Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega, thank you, sir, for joining me today. Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Thank you, Ms. Davila. Always. Bye-bye.
Always. Thank you, sir.